Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, good evening, whenever you're watching. This is our Easter broadcast, and so our focus is going to be on the resurrection, and we hear that ancient cry, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed, and that's what we're celebrating today. And you know, in one sense, every Sunday when we gather in churches around the globe, we are acknowledging Jesus' great triumph over death, sin, and the cross. And we're so glad that we could be here today to celebrate that. So as we go into that great celebration, let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for this day, this resurrection day. And we thank you for that triumph over sin and death and the cross. And we're so thankful that that cross stands empty to the sky and that tomb is rolled away and empty. And so as we enter into worship, help us to keep our eyes and our minds and our hearts focused on that great and glorious truth, the rock and foundation of our faith. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, to get us started, Chris is coming forward to sing Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Soul of bliss, Alleluia. Everlasting life is this. Alleluia. Thee to know, thy power to prove. Alleluia. Thus to sing and thus to love. Alleluia.
At this time, we'll have our Psalter reading.
And it is Psalm number 118. The Lord is my strength and my power. The Lord has become my salvation.
There are joyous songs of victory in the tents of the righteous.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly.
I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord.
The Lord has chastened me sorely, but has not given me over to death.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter in.
I thank you that you have answered me and become my salvation.
The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it.
Save us, we beseech you, O Lord.
O Lord, we beseech you, give us success.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
We bless you from the house of David.
The Lord is God who has given us light.
Lead the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and the Lord's steadfast love endures forever. And with that joyful thought of his love, which endures forever, we'll turn to him at this time in prayer and thanksgiving, and then we'll have a time of the service where we'll pause and you can lift up your heartfelt concerns to him, personal concerns, and I would even say, do that audibly. Speak to the Lord, and then we'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Gracious God, we come to you on this resurrection celebration, and indeed every day is a resurrection day because we serve a living Savior, and he's in the world today. And we thank you for that great truth. And we just praise you and thank you, Lord, that we look forward to an eternity with our risen Savior. And we just thank you, God, that we have had that testimony for over 2,000 years, that he lives indeed. Gracious God, we thank you for his presence in our lives. We thank you for each and every blessing. We thank you for family and friends and dear ones and loved ones. And we thank you, God, that by his grace we stand before your throne, not on our merits, not on what we do or don't do, but by his grace, his love, and his mercy alone. We thank you, God, that you have invited us into that heartfelt relationship with him. Lord, as we look around, we see many issues in our world. We see many problems in our world. But we know, Lord, the source and the cure for those problems, and that's you. Lord, we see war and violence and destruction, hatred and prejudice and so many things, Lord. And we just want to cut through all of that with the love of Jesus. Help us to exhibit that love better and better each and every day. We want to lift up those who are ill in mind, body, or spirit, Lord. We lift them up to you, and we just ask a very special blessing on them. And now, God, we want to pause to lift up those things which are on our hearts at this time. All of this we ask, Lord, even as we pray those words which Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, our chorus is coming forward to bring another song of praise.
Christ is alive, let Christians sing. His cross stands empty to the sky. Let streets and homes with praises ring. His love in death shall never die. Christ is alive, no longer bound to distant years in Palestine. He comes to claim the here and now and dwell in every place and time. Not throned afar, remotely high, untouched, unmoved by human pains, but daily in the midst of life, our Savior in the Godhead reigns. In every insult, rift, and war, where color, scorn, or wealth divide, he suffers still, yet loves the more, and lives though ever crucified. Christ is alive and comes to bring good news to this and every age, till earth and all creation ring with joy, with justice, love, and praise.
From the Old Testament, from the book of the prophet Isaiah, this is chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, a rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. From the New Testament, the reading is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 1 through 11. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. And from the gospel, the reading is from the gospel according to Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices that they might go and anoint him with. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is a place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And may God bless the reading of his holy word.
Let's turn to the Lord in prayer again at this time. Gracious God, open our eyes to the wonders and the glories of the resurrection. Help us to see things anew and afresh. May we stand at that empty tomb amazed. In Jesus' name, amen. What do you do when there doesn't seem to be anything left to do? How do you respond when all of your plans go awry and your hopes are dashed and the darkness seems to be overwhelming what little light remains? Thoughts of the future seem futile. Well, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had faithfully followed the Savior, and now it seems that everything they had pinned their hopes on was gone. And we may ask, just what were they expecting when they went to the tomb that day? Well, I think we can well assume they did not expect soldiers fleeing and stones rolled away and empty tombs and grave cloths with no one in them in the tomb. Whatever it was, it doesn't seem that they were expecting an encounter with a living, risen Christ. They came to do one thing. They came to anoint the body of the one they loved so much. You see, they were fulfilling the customs and the traditions of the Hebrew people. We recall just how central women were during that earthly ministry of Jesus. They followed him, they supported his ministry, they ate with him, and they opened their hearts to him, and they came to Jesus seeking answers to their dilemmas and their challenges. And Jesus affirmed them in this. We remember the story of Mary and Martha, when Martha was scurrying around trying to get dinner ready for Jesus and the apostles and was kind of in a tizzy, and there was Mary quietly sitting at Jesus' feet. Of course, Martha was very upset, but Jesus said, "No, Mary has chosen the better part." He affirmed their presence in his life and in his ministry. They were the last ones at the foot of the cross, and they took the body of Jesus away for proper burial. They were committed. They were in for the long haul. They were not just passerbys. They were committed to Christ. When so many of the disciples had fled in terror, when they were trembling behind closed and locked doors, when even one of them denied knowing him, poor old Peter, the faithful women were still there. But this tells us something, that obedience isn't rooted in knowledge alone, but in faith and trust and hope. This event tells us that I will follow, though none go with me. They didn't know what they were expecting when they went to that tomb. They didn't know what the future held, but they did what they were called to do, nevertheless, come what may. Even when there was no one to roll the stones away from your life, there is one who will, and that's the Lord Jesus, and you can depend on him. No stone is too large, no stone is too heavy, no stone is so implacable that the risen Christ cannot roll that stone away. In the resurrection, everything has changed. Nothing remains the same. When those women left that empty tomb, things would never, ever be the same again. As someone reminds us, the resurrection of Jesus changes the face of death for all people. Death is no longer a prison. It's not a permanent state of being, but a passage into God's presence. Easter says that you can put truth in a grave, but it's not going to stay there. You can nail it to a cross. It's not going to stay there. You can wrap it in winding sheets, place it in a tomb, and roll a stone in front of that tomb, but it will rise. The women were the very first to proclaim the great good news that Christ is risen. We can well imagine the range of emotions those women had experienced that day. And really, in the last few days, we remember the great celebration of Palm Sunday just a week ago with shouts of Hosanna. And then we remember the somberness of Maundy Thursday and the sadness of Good Friday. And then, of course, that sort of empty day in between, right? That Saturday between the Good Friday and Resurrection Easter Sunday morning. Indeed, they had so much to contemplate during that week. These women were empowered by the resurrection event and overcame their fears and proclaimed the good news. They rushed to the disciples to tell them he is risen. The joyful news that he is risen does not change the contemporary world. Still, before us lie work and discipline and sacrifice. But the fact of Easter, the fact of the resurrection, gives us the power, that spiritual encouragement, that spiritual energy to do the work, accept the discipline, and even to make the sacrifice we need to make. The change in those women's lives was an encounter with the risen Savior, and that made all the difference in the world. And that is the same for you and me as well. And that is what empowers us to step up boldly and courageously for the Lord. And empowers us, because all of us are gifted to do something for the Lord. Jesus' resurrection, writes N.T. Wright, is the beginning of God's new project, not to snatch people away from earth to heaven, but to colonize earth with the life of heaven. That, after all, is what the Lord's Prayer is all about. You know, Jesus could just rescue us immediately, right? Well, take us right to heaven. Just take us right to heaven. We commit ourselves to him, and then off we go. But that's not the way he chose to do it. He chose to leave us here in this world to do his will. There was a story told that after the Second World War in a church in Europe, there was a statue of Christ, and it was in a classic pose, his arms are out like this, and the hands of the statues had been destroyed in the war. Well, a committee of the church had gotten together and they decided, well, what could we do to raise funds and to restore the statue, this beloved, beautiful statue that inspired so many people? Well, after some contemplation, they decided rather than to restore it, they left it just the way it was. And at the foot of the statue, they put a little sign, and it's as if Jesus is speaking, and he says, "You be my hands in the world." That's what he's called us to do. We're not snatched out into heaven immediately. We're left here to be his hands and his feet and his loving physical presence in a very hurt and broken world. The resurrection does not simply give us a hope of heaven, which it does, but it gives us meaning and purpose and service for this life. The attitude of the women was that they had come to pay their last tribute to Christ, to do the traditions of their people. The attitude of the disciples was that everything was finished in tragedy. All they had hoped for, following Jesus for the last 3 years, was at an end. By far the best proof, however, of the resurrection is the very existence of Christ's church in the world. Nothing else could have changed sad and despairing men and women into people radiant with joy and flaming with courage. The resurrection is the central fact of the entire Christian faith. Because we believe in the resurrection, certain things must follow. Number one, Jesus is not simply a figure in a book, but a living presence. He's just not one of a number of many people throughout human history. It is not enough to simply study the story of Jesus like the life of any other great historical figure, like Jefferson or Washington or someone like that. We may begin that way, but we must end by meeting him. The point of the scriptures, the point of the Holy Bible, is to introduce us to that living, risen Christ and to go into a relationship with him. The second thing is that Jesus is not simply a memory, but a presence in our hearts and lives. The dearest of memories, at times, as we know, fade. The Greeks had a word to describe time, meaning time which wipes out all things. Long since, time would have wiped out the memory of Jesus unless he had been a living presence forever with us. That's what emboldened the disciples. They eventually broke through those locked doors and went out into the world and went into the entire known world of their day to tell the good news that Jesus was risen and that Jesus loves you. As someone wrote, "The warm, sweet, tender, yet even, a present help is he, and faith has still its Olivet, and love its Galilee." Jesus is not someone to discuss and to debate and to contemplate about. He is someone to meet and to know on a heartfelt, personal basis. We need that living encounter with the living Christ. That is what makes the difference in our hearts and lives and should make a difference each and every day. As we read in the psalm, "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." Every day that we wake with the risen Christ. And the third thing is that the Christian life is not the life of a person who knows about Jesus. Most people, at least in the Western world, know about Jesus. But the life of a person who knows Jesus, there's a very big difference there. There's all the difference in the world between knowing about a person and knowing a person. Most people know about King Charles or the president or the governor or some famous actor or sports figure. We know about them. But most of us don't know them. We're not personal acquaintances. We're not friends with them. We don't socialize with these people. We know about them, but we don't know them. The greatest scholar in the world who knows everything about Jesus is less than the humblest Christian who knows him as Savior and Lord. There is an endless quality about the Christian faith. It should never stand still. It's always growing. It's growing. It's being nurtured by the Spirit, and it's growing each and every day. Because our Lord is a living Lord, there are new wonders and truths to be discovered all the time, each and every day. The most precious thing in this passage is the two words which are in no other gospel. Go, said the messenger. Tell his disciples and Peter. How the message must have cheered Peter's heart when he received it. He must have been tortured with the memory of his disloyalty. We remember that Peter denied Jesus not once, not twice, but thrice. Three times he denied the Savior. And suddenly there came a special message just for him. It was characteristic of Jesus that he thought not of the wrong Peter had done, but the remorse he was undergoing. And that shows us as well, our walk with the Lord may very often be three steps forward and two steps back, but he never tosses us aside. He never rejects us. He always invites us back again and again into that living relationship with him. Jesus was far more eager to confront the penitent sinner than to punish the sin. He's not willing that any should perish, the Bible says, but that all should come to eternal life. That's the depth and the width and the love of Jesus. Someone has said the most precious thing about Jesus is the way in which he trusts us, even on the field of our defeats. Yes, we are called, you and I, to tell others about that living Savior who suffered, died, and rose for us and our salvation. These were ordinary women that were at the tomb that morning, ordinary women who had walked with Jesus. But ordinary women, ordinary men, ordinary people become extraordinary when they are transformed by that encounter with our extraordinary Christ. Max Lucado shares the following. In Romans 6:9, the Apostle Paul said, when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was a signal of the end of death as an end. The resurrection of Jesus is the exploding fire announcing to all sincere seekers that it's safe to believe. Because of the resurrection, everything changes. Nothing stays the same. Death changes. It used to be the end, now it's the beginning. Even the cemetery changes. People once went there to say goodbye, but now they go there to say, until we meet again. Even a coffin changes. It's no longer a box to entomb a body, to hide a body, but rather it's like a butterfly's cocoon in which the body is kept until God sets it free to fly. In John 14, Jesus said, I will come back and take you to be with me. And to prove that, he was serious about his promise. That stone was rolled away and his body was raised from the dead. What a great comfort that is to know that there is one who is waiting for us at that final hour, even if we're utterly alone as far as other human companions are concerned. We are never alone at that final hour because he is with us. Jesus said, I will never leave you or forsake you. And never means never. He is there and he promises to remain there no matter what. And that too is the hope of the resurrection. It's not just for that final moment. It's not just for eternity. It's for our daily walk with him each and every day. The resurrection of Christ changes the midnight of bereavement into a sunrise of reunion. It changed the midnight of disappointment into a sunrise of joy. It changed the midnight of fear into a sunrise of peace. Christ broke the bonds of death itself by his resurrection. The power of the resurrection is in knowing that the very one who was raised, Jesus Christ, is with you at this moment in time. The difference between knowing Christ and knowing the power of his resurrection, said Tim Keller, is the difference between knowing a person and resembling a person. It is not about relationship, but about supernatural growth development. When Paul said, I want to know him, it means I want to be with him. But when he says, I want to know the power of his resurrection, it means I want to be like him. It's like that old gospel song, Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. And the last verse is, Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart. That's what we're saying when we identify with the resurrection. So look at the deadness in your life. Look at the anger. How is it going to be turned into forgiveness? Because forgiveness benefits not only the one being forgiven, but the one who is forgiving. Because non-forgiveness is a deadly thing to hold on to. Look at the insecurity. How is it going to be turned into confidence? Not confidence in ourselves, but confidence in the one who's with us, the Lord Jesus. Look at self-centeredness. How is this going to be turned into compassion and caring and generosity? The answer is the dead stuff gets taken over by the Spirit of God, and the minute you decide to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord, the power of the Spirit comes into your life. It's the power, that power of the resurrection, the same thing that raised Jesus from the dead. The resurrection of Christ is the grounding of our faith and the assurance that we too shall rise. 1 John reminds us, we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for he shall see him as he is. Can you imagine to be like him? I don't think we can even wrap our minds around that great truth. But somehow, we will be like him. We know we are the adopted daughters and sons of God. The Bible tells us that. Amazing. Just think about that, to be like him. That is the triumph, the ultimate triumph of the resurrection. That's the living hope that we possess. And that is the hope that we share with this world around us. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for that risen Christ and his presence in our lives. And we just pray, God, that we will share that hope, that living hope, with all around us. For we ask it in the risen Christ's name. Amen. Well, as we finish up, Chris is coming forward to bring our final hymn of praise.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever foes may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care, and though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christ, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
Indeed, he lives within my heart. Let's pray for God's blessing as we depart, and I want to wish you a very blessed resurrection season, because it really is a season of hope. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord make his countenance rise upon you and give you his peace in your going out and your coming in, your lying down and your rising up, in your laughter and in your tears, into that great and glorious day, that eternal resurrection day. The blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.